Welcome back from that break. This is Family Unscripted with me, Lynn Komjisha. I have with me Peter Bahemka, who is a senior program officer at Raising Voices. We are trying to understand the forms of violence and the impact these forms of violence have on children. Because, man, we do all these things innocently. Sometimes we just, you know, get angry over our children, but we don't know how that is affecting them. Peter, we were looking at the different forms of violence and how, you know, they happen. But now we want to understand, why is violence, why is sexual violence, why is physical violence, why is emotional violence prevalent despite the existing laws?
Okay, thank you, Lynn. I wanted also to respond to something that you said.
Yes.
About unknowingly. You know,
uh-huh.
We do a lot of the violence that we commit, we commit it in ignorance.
Yes.
A child who is being beaten because they didn't do well in mathematics,
yeah.
The teacher believes if they beat the child, the child will pull up their socks.
Mm-hmm.
For a parent who is abusing their child, that, you know, why can't you get it? They believe that if they, you know, if they say those nasty words to the child will kind of like get it and, you know, and realize, oh, I need to behave differently. And so the majority of us parents, the majority of us teachers, we are doing the best for the child, but we are using the wrong method. We are using pain, we are using fear, we are using coercion, we are using harassment.
And abuse.
So it is wrong, but the majority of us actually don't know.
Mm.
Now you're asking, why is it prevalent?
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning I said it is socially accepted. Violence is socially accepted.
It should not be.
It shouldn't.
Yes.
It shouldn't at all. But then we understand that children are a delicate group of people. They are minors. In other words, they don't make most of the decisions that concern their lives.
Mm.
We decide where they go to school, we decide what they'll eat, we decide, which bed they'll sleep on.
Mm-hmm.
And so we make a lot of the decisions for them.
Mm-hmm.
And that is our responsibility as parents, but also as caregivers, for example, as teachers. Now, that's that status of a person kind of makes the person who is responsible for that person to look at that person as subhuman. You know, human rights are for every human being,
including children. Yes.
But sometimes we think like, when I speak, Elaine, you as a child
should shut up.
You should only speak when you are asked to speak. Children don't have ideas. Children cannot correct a teacher because the teacher knows it, knows it all. They went to school, they were trained, they are graduated.
That is the social set.
Yes, that's the social set. A child is there to be seen, but not necessarily to be heard. You know, when elders are speaking, you as a child, even if you think the elders are taking it the wrong way, you can't, you know, you have to wait until you are asked. And so children are in that state. They go to school, the school administration and the teachers are responsible for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can imagine 1,000 kids. There's one head teacher and a few teachers who are responsible for all of them. And so their rights are being held for them by somebody else.
Mm.
And that makes violence become an issue that sometimes is debated, yet it shouldn't be debated.
True.
It is a real problem.
True.
It shouldn't even occur. And so it is important or incumbent upon us as parents, as adults, to realize the child is a full human being.
Mm.
Just because of their agency, I mean their age, they can't exercise agency.
Yes.
Now, for example, for me, I can decide to say, look, Lynn has invited me for this program, but I'm too busy, I can't come. I can call you and say, you know, I can't come. But if I was a child, it could be an issue if I didn't come. And so, agency.
Yes.
How do we help children exercise agency?
Mm.
We can help children exercise agency using age-appropriate methods. For example, a child can be taught how to do house chores.
Mm-hmm.
But a three-year-old can't do house chores.
Yeah.
They can do, you know, play things, you know, oh, okay, help me bring this, but not necessarily as a chore, but just to keep them busy. A seven-year-old can do certain things in the home.
Yeah.
And a 10-year-old can do certain things in the home. You know, a 16-year-old can do certain things. You know, so we can use their age as a lever to get them to do certain things.
Absolutely.
But we shouldn't do it in a way that shows that, you know, when we tell you to to wash the dishes, that it is a punishment. So when washing the dishes becomes a punishment, then in a way, the child appreciates it, that, you know, washing dishes
is punishment.
Is punishment.
Yeah.
Yet it's a good thing. It's a life skill.
Yes.
That we are helping a child to, you know, to learn how to live in a community.
Mm.
If a child is 15 and you are teaching them how to do some cooking, it is not a punishment. It's not even a substitute for play.
Right.
Play is quite critical in a child's life.
Mm.
But cooking is equally important, because, you know, if we don't eat, we will not survive. So we do it in a way that it is not excessive, in a way that helps build the person's, you know, the child's personality, but also, you know, gives them life skills.
Right.
But sometimes we get it the wrong way. So cleaning the compound is a punishment, you know, washing the dishes is a punishment, ironing clothes, you know, in the home.
I think that's why we have most lazy children around. Okay, well, they're adults now, but they're lazy.
Because they didn't appreciate some of these things. And so we also need to do it as we communicate or imbibe values, as we teach them right from wrong. Because sometimes we cane our children in school, in the home, without explaining why something is wrong.
Right.
It is important for a child to learn that this is wrong, and these are the consequences.
Yeah.
This is right, and these are the benefits for me as an individual, but also for my family, for my, you know, for my siblings, for my friends, for my school. And people will appreciate that it is important to do certain things. I'll give you an example. In Uganda, we do have a problem of late coming.
Oh yeah.
We arrive late for work at the office, yet in primary school we were caned for arriving late.
Huh.
So if caning was to teach us
don't give employers time, ideas.
No, they won't cane you, because then it will become a human rights issue. But if we were taught the value of time,
right?
Why is time important in our lives? We would be good time managers. But in Uganda today, talk about any person you want to talk about. We arrive late. When we are invited for weddings, a wedding is at 4, we arrive at 6.
Yeah.
Because, you know, nobody told us, look, time is precious. Time is a commodity. Time is a rare commodity. If the time has gone, it's gone.
It's gone.
In some countries, people leave time. You're late to get to the Tokyo train station. You miss that train that's going to another city, Nagasaki. Your entire day could be messed up. And those are the consequences of not keeping time. But in Uganda,
it's okay.
It's okay. We don't have those consequences.
So, Peter,
we need to imbibe values, lessons, knowledge in children as we teach them right from wrong. We don't have to use violent means to help them appreciate values.
Right. Are there existing laws that are being, you know, what should I call it, that are not being respected?
Yes. For example, we do have the Constitution.
Yeah.
That's the number one law, the mother of all laws in Uganda. The Constitution grants children rights. For example, the right to education. It is a right, but many times we find children are not in school.
Yeah.
And so right from us as individuals, but also government, that is something that we need to pay attention to. Then we have other laws like the Children Amendment Act 2016.
Yes.
That law talks about many things, But I'll give you a few highlights.
Right.
It defines violence against children.
Mm-hmm.
It prohibits corporal punishment
mm-hmm.
in institutions of learning, like schools, but teachers still do cane.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the challenge in Uganda is that we do have good laws, but the dissemination is often lacking.
True.
Does the teacher in Nakapiripirit know that corporal punishment is illegal?
I don't think so.
They may not know.
Yeah.
Does the head teacher in Kabale, in a school in Kabale, know that, you know, caning child is illegal?
Mm.
It's a criminal offense. Probably they don't know. And so the laws need to be disseminated. And that's where the media come in, the NGOs come in, but also government still needs to play that role. Teach the LC officials, teach the medical practitioners, health practitioners, teach the teachers, teach the social workers about the law.
Right.
So that as they do their work, they know what the law says.
Mm.
Now, the Children Amendment Act mandates four people to report suspicion or cases of violence that they have, you know, seen or encountered.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're a medical doctor, a health worker, and a child comes for healthcare services and presents symptoms of violence, you know, they appear to have been either defiled or abused or slapped or caned, and they show marks. It is important that the health worker reports to the authorities, and the authorities include the police. If a teacher comes to know that a child is being abused in their home, it is their responsibility to report. They can report to the head teacher, so that the head teacher then takes it on, you know, to the higher authorities.
Yes.
The LCs, if an LC looks the other way, they are abetting.
Yes.
They are helping the violence happen. Remember I said the violence is perpetrated by people
by
we know.
By people we know.
So sometimes the LCs may want to cover up for their friends. It is important that they know the law mandates them, requires them to report. Equally, the social worker, whenever they come into contact with a child who's been abused, it is incumbent upon them to do a report. The laws are there, but the implementation is lacking.
Right.
Now, then the other aspect of the law is also that upon us as individuals to report.
Yeah.
Sometimes we think of reporting violence against children as the responsibility of someone else. No, we have a responsibility. You as a journalist, you as a media person, I as an NGO worker, somebody as an uncle, as a relative, all of us have
a role to play,
a responsibility
right.
to report. Whatever action we take can help that child. Because if I saw my neighbor beating a child or locking the child in the house instead of taking the child to school, and I reported, that child will benefit, but also my society will benefit, because an educated child is of benefit to the broader society.
Right, Peter, thank you so very much for that. We'll take a quick break. When we return, we look at, I want to know, how do I, as a person, you there watching, and Peter here, how do I tell a child is being abused? We'll be right back.